Hi everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Today we are going to start a new chapter in physics. According to NCERT, if you consider, there are two books for first year, and the first chapter of second part, part 2 physics first PUC is solids, mechanical properties of solids. First of all, if you consider the matter, it is of three types. Matter is of three types. As you have already studied in chemistry also, solid, liquid and gas. A matter can exist three different states, like ice, water, vapor. Ice is solid state, water is liquid state, and vapor is gaseous state. So a substance or a material or a matter can exist in three different states. Those are solids, liquids and gases. So in part 2 of first PUC physics, we study about the properties of solids, liquids and gas in sequence. First, we will study about solids. Then we study about liquids. Then we study about gas. But first we will study about mechanical properties. Then we study about thermal properties. First mechanical properties, then thermal properties. So thermal properties we study later. But first of all, let us try to understand what is the meaning of title of the chapter. Nothing but mechanical properties of matter. So what is the meaning? What exactly it defines? Or what it is actually about? That's what let us try to understand. See, mechanics means a study or a portion of or a part of physics where we study about the forces and the effect of forces on the substance or a body, like motion, loss of motion, work energy power, rotational motion, different type of motion. So a motion or motion of a body is possible due to force. Who is responsible for motion of a body? Force. And that part of motion we will divide into two parts, like kinematics and dynamics, where study of motion without considering the forces, that is kinematics, till motion in two dimension. After that, you will study about study of motion by considering all the forces, that is called dynamics. But all together it's like mechanics 1. Next comes mechanics 2, where you will study mechanical properties of matter, where matter is of three types. Now if you apply the force, if we apply force, what happens? So, if we apply force on an object or a particle or body, then the possibilities are the body may move from rest, or the body may stop moving or the body can change its direction of motion. Change its direction of motion. These are the three things possible, but when you study about mechanics part 1. But when you talk about in depth bit more, then what is the other possibility is the body may undergo deformation. Just like, see, what is happening? If you apply force on the skin, then the skin is little bit coming out. So the body is undergoing deformation. There is a change happening in the shape or size, something. So these kind of, it is not moving. Slight movement is there, don't consider like it is a motion. So, but after applying force, there is a change in the shape or size of the body. Like you take the duster, I applied force. Then what happened? Its shape changed. So, apart from these three, there is one more thing possible, that the body may undergo deformation. So, force is a quantity which is responsible for motion. Also, in few cases, in particular situation, it is also responsible for deformation. And that force, the force which we apply such that or in such a situation, the body undergoes deformation, that is called deforming force. Deforming force. So when you apply deforming force on an object, on a substance, on a body, then what are the consequences? What are all the properties we can study about liquids or solids? Those things we call it as mechanical properties of matter. So, when there is a application of force on the solid or liquid or gas, the nature is different, the behavior is different, which we have to study and which comes under mechanical properties of matter. Mechanical properties of matter. But right now we are taking the first state of the matter, that is solids. So now we talk about only solids. Next we talk about liquids. Next we talk about gas. Or we will also say fluids. Fluid means which can flow. Nothing but like liquid or gas. Both will flow. Solid will not flow. It will move, but it will not flow. So that is what the main thing, the initial and the fundamental thing we should know before knowing or studying this chapter is, what is deforming force? The deforming force is a force, when you apply it on the body or substance, it causes a kind of deformation, like change in the shape or size of the body. That kind of force, or that force we call it as deforming force. But in few cases, that deformation is negligible. That deformation is negligible. But that deformation depends on two things. One is nature of the substance, amount of force. Suppose you take, see, I apply force on the this sponge, duster. Now its shape is changing easily. But if I apply same force on this marker, the shape is not changing. So, that doesn't mean that this cannot undergo deformation. My force is not sufficient to undergo or cause some deformation in this body, but my force is good enough to deform this body. So deformation depends upon amount of force as well as nature of the substance. So if there is a substance, if there is a body which cannot undergo any deformation even after applying some maximum deformation force, that is called rigid body. Rigid means something which cannot undergo deformation. But it is not possible in practicality. You take any body, any substance, at one particular point, it must undergo deformation. So, there is no such substance which is completely rigid body, like which cannot undergo any deformation even after applying deforming force. But an approximate behavior is suitable for diamond. So diamond is a kind of material which is so strong that it is not that easy to deform it. That's why we will call it as like approximate behavior, not perfect one. Because there is no perfect rigid body. Only diamond can be approximated as, or its behavior can be approximated as rigid body. So why we are talking about rigid body? Because in this chapter we study about those substances which are not rigid. So almost everything is not rigid. But in that, there are two categories. There are two categories. So what is that? So the non-rigid bodies you can categorize into two things. That is elastic and plastic. We divide them into two types again. One is elastic and another one is plastic. Elastic and plastic. What is the meaning of elastic body? What is the meaning of plastic body? What is the nature of elasticity? What is the nature of plasticity? We need to understand. So, just I conclude. The everything related to mechanical properties starts with deforming force. The consequences are the properties which we will study related to solids. When you apply deforming force, those are called mechanical properties of solids. And where deforming force is something which changes or tries to change the shape or size of the substance, that force is called deforming force. So that is what deforming force, and based on the deforming force and deformation occurred, we again divide the solids into two types. One is elastic bodies, another one is plastic bodies. So let us try to understand elasticity and plasticity. Now, so the first thing is elasticity and another one is plasticity. See, whatever we are talking about deforming force, when there is a substance, solid substance, you apply deforming force. You apply deforming force. So when you apply deforming force, there is a change in the shape or size of the body, and if you remove the force, I applied the force and I removed, then it is regaining its original shape. See, I deformed by applying some force, which is called deforming force, and I removed, then it is coming back to its original shape or size. So how it is possible? That is secondary thing. But this is able to, this body is able to regain its original shape. Somehow there may be little bit change. But overall if you look at the object, the body is able to regain its original shape or size. Such object we call it as elastic body. Elastic body. Such property, what is that property? The property of regaining its original shape. Such property of regaining its original shape after removing deforming force. Apply the deforming force, change, remove the deforming force, then regaining. So such body is elastic body. Such behavior or such property is called elasticity. But every body is elastic, almost. Every body is elastic up to range. So what is that meaning is, the maximum deforming force you can apply such that it can regain its original shape or size, that limit is called elastic limit. See, suppose I am trying to stretch it. If you keep on stretch, then what happens? It will break. So up to some limit only it is possible, and up to some limit every substance is elastic only, and every substance shows elastic behavior. Same thing, see, I told you, like, try to apply force on the skin. See, if you take a plier and apply the force and pull it, then at a point your skin will come out, then it won't regain its original shape. So there is a limit for every elastic behavior. That is called elastic limit. What is that? Elastic limit. So elasticity is a property of regaining its original shape after removing deforming force. And those substances which show such behavior, they call it as elastic bodies. And all substances are almost, they are elastic. They show a kind of elastic behavior, but up to some limit. Under the limit of elastic limit, they show their behavior of elasticity. Right? Now, let's come to plasticity. So, elasticity means regaining. So, obviously, plasticity means unable to regain. It is unable to regain its original shape or size. Like you take the cap of this marker. There is an edge. So if I apply little force, it is coming back. But if I keep on apply force, then it will bend. And there is a permanent change in the shape. So it will slightly slant at some angle. It will be in a position. It will settle in a position at some angle. Up to some little force, it is able to regain it. But if I apply very greater force at a particular limit, it won't regain its original shape. So that kind of nature, we call it as plasticity. Unable to regain its size or shape. But you should not confuse about one thing. So under the elastic limit, every substance is elastic. So beyond that, they become plastic bodies. So you cannot say like these are completely elastic bodies, these are completely plastic bodies. There is no 100% elastic body. Only one substance, the name is quartz. The quartz is there, one material, approximately elastic body. And if you consider plastic bodies, for example, wax. You know wax. it will undergo deformation very easily and it won't regain its shape. Also putty. So these are the examples. These are the examples which cannot regain their shape that easily. These are called like, even after applying little force, when you try to apply force, they undergo deformation which cannot be regained by the body. So such bodies we call it as plastic bodies. But there are very few examples, 3-4 examples only, which are perfectly, are almost plastic bodies. Here also only one example which is perfectly elastic body. But rest of the bodies if you consider, that is elastic as well as plastic. Under certain limit it is elastic. Beyond that it is plastic. You take a wire also, try to stretch it. Initially it will regain, but after applying the force continuously for a while, then it got a permanent change in its length. So that's why every substance shows elasticity as well as plasticity, except few objects. Those also approximately only. So this is the behavior of elasticity and plasticity, and those are the substances we call it as elastic bodies and plastic bodies. So this is the introduction of this chapter. So the study of the property elasticity of the substance, solid substance, we call it as mechanical properties, which is possible only when you apply deforming force on the solid body. What do you have to apply? Deforming force. Right? Now, one more thing we can define here. Actually, based, not one thing, there are two things. And based on that only, whole chapter will run. And the questions also will come based on that. That is, after deforming force and after elasticity and plasticity, we can define two more things. Stress and strain. Stress. Stress means load. Whether it is physical or mental, usually we talk about stress, of course. In this period, over the past 8 months, we all are having so much stress because of the various situations. Similar way, when you define stress in physics, it is nothing but load on the body. Load acting on the body. But that load affects based on the area also. See, when you have stress on your mind, so what kind of stress? Based depending on that, the stress levels will be different. Similar way, here the amount of force acting on amount of area decides the stress level of the on the body. So what is stress? Stress means force per unit area. If you apply greater force on the lesser area, then stress is more. I'll tell you. See, you take like your hand and try to push someone like this. Like this. You use all your strength to push the person like this. This way. Suppose here on his stomach. Then he feels some stress on the stomach. But when you take your hand with the nail and apply force, same amount of force, and try to press, then he feels more stress on the stomach. Why? Because same amount of force you are applying but on the smaller area. This is big area, but this is small area. Because of small area, the stress is more. That's why we say that stress is inversely proportional to area. So stress develops when you apply force, but that force tries to or should try to change the shape or size, then we have to say it deforming force. What force? Deforming force per unit area is called stress. Stress is nothing but deforming force acting per unit area on the substance or body. Even you take a knife, hold it on your in your hand and try to same push or apply it on the stomach, that will become murder, of course. That is different thing. But I am just talking about the stress applying on the stomach. It will penetrate into the stomach because the knife edge is very sharper. It is even sharper than your finger. So the area of contact is even lesser because of the less contact. That means the lesser area in contact, the denominator is even lesser. So the value is higher. Stress is more. So that because of high stress, it will penetrate through the skin. So lesser the area, then greater the stress. Suppose you stand on your 2 feet, then for suppose 1 hour, you feel stress on your legs. But if you try to stand on 1 foot like this, if you try to stand on one foot, then what happens? The area of contact with the ground decreases. Same force, your weight is acting on the foot. Your weight will be balanced by your foot. So what force is applying? Your weight. Same force, deforming force is same, but area is lesser now, only 1 foot. So area less means stress is more. So on one leg, the stress is more. So that way, the stress develops in a solid when there is a deforming force. And that stress also depends upon area. So deforming force acting per unit area is defined as stress. Now, similar way, you can define connecting with stress. One more thing, strain. So what is that strain? Strain is deformation in the object. Deformation in the object by or you can say like change in the dimension. Change in the dimension means when there is a stress on the body, there is a change happens in the size or shape, I said. So there may be change in the length or area or volume, something. So that change in the dimension, you can also take it like change in the dimension divided by original or initial dimension. Like suppose length got changed, then change in length by initial length. So it depends on situation, but there is a change in one quantity, one dimension of the substance. So that change in the dimension of the substance by initial one, also you can say like this, you can define like this: change in the configuration. Change in the configuration divided by initial configuration. Configuration means what? Initial dimensions. So there is a change in the dimension divided by there is a initial original value. So that is called strain. So
when there is a deforming force, then there is a stress develops and it causes there is a change in the dimension, which is called strain. So deforming force causes stress and stress develops strain. So based on these two things, we will continue the chapter where there are three different type of stress and strain, and there is a law called Hooke's law, which connects, which gives relation between stress and strain. And based on that law, we define three different constants: Young's modulus, bulk modulus, and rigidity modulus. So what are those laws? What are those constants? All those things we will study in the coming class. So today, if you take the just brief review of what we studied, we have studied about first deforming force, where deforming force causes stress and strain. And when you consider the matter, there are three types: solids, liquids, gases. And these solids are like rigid and elastic and plastic. So this way, when you complete the chapter, you have to draw a diagram, one page diagram, by looking at which you will come to know where it starts, how it starts, and what are all the things we will study in this chapter, like a brief review of the complete chapter that I will give you at the end of the chapter, right? So please understand every definition, please understand each and every the point what we discussed, and try to remember everything so we can understand the further things easily, right? So that is what all about the introduction of solids, or better to say mechanical properties of solids, right? We'll continue in the coming lecture. Thank you.